today, actually, first of all, I want to tell you something very special. And this is not about a research paper. Every day, as usually, we do some research papers. We discuss some research papers here. But this is not about research. And this presentation is all about presentation. So then what? And you may wonder, actually, I have named my presentation as Beyond Bullets. So what does it mean by, what are these bullets? Actually, these bullets are not the bullets that you are familiar with. And also, the term bullets refers to the bullets that you use in your PowerPoint presentations. Right. So, moving ahead, I'd like to show you the content and what we are going to discuss today. And especially, I would like to talk about what kinds of content work best in PowerPoint. And this is all about PowerPoint presentations. And what should we include in PowerPoint? What should not include in PowerPoint? At the same time, how PowerPoint might affect the student recall. And the last point is my focus actually, that is considerations for slide design. Under this part, slide design is the technical aspects of PowerPoint presentations. And you will think, what does it mean by technical aspects? The fonts, font sizes, font types, and also templates, designs. And I think this is really important to you all because as lecturers, academics, and also researchers, we all have to use PowerPoint presentations frequently in our lifetime. That means maybe in conferences, maybe in our lectures, we have to use this PowerPoint presentation. But the problem is whether we use this PowerPoint correctly, right? So, before we move on to this slide, I just want to focus the history of PowerPoint presentations. So the history is, as you all know, Microsoft PowerPoint is a presentation program, and which is currently developed by Microsoft to use on Microsoft Windows and also Macintosh operating systems. So this is actually the initial release was called Presenter, not PowerPoint, and this was designed by Robert Gustin and Dennis Austin in 1987. And also the later on, they renamed this to PowerPoint. Now we use this as PowerPoint, and that is actually a little history. And I just want to show you something. Let's have a look at all this. So I'm going to show you PowerPoint presentation, but after that I need some answers from your side. And what do you think about this PowerPoint? This PowerPoint is actually not mine, right? So this is downloaded PowerPoint from the internet. So what do you think about this? I just want to have the both good and bad sides. Actually, the content is not important here. My focus is the other facts.
Being conducted all around the world, maybe in this university, right?
But the problem is most of them are ineffective. Why? So I'm going to give you answers for this question today. Right? Why these things are ineffective? First, we have to know that the PowerPoint presentation, the presentation is not a PowerPoint. But most of presenters think presentation is totally about PowerPoint. That is not. Then what is PowerPoint? It is you, the presenter, and then the other party is audience. We have two important factors here. One is the presenter. If we take today's example, I'm the presenter and you are going to be my audience. Right? So you can see one image and you can see my presentation from beginning to the end, the font sizes, fonts and images that I've used in my presentation. So you can see this image. And what is this image? Why I have used this image into my PowerPoint presentation for this slide? Who is this? Yes? Steve Jobs. And why we won't think about Steve Jobs when we talk about PowerPoint presentation? Actually, Steve Paul Jobs was an American entrepreneur. At the same time, he's a businessman. Especially, he's the co-founder of Apple company. And he's the creator of these Apple iPhones. And the importance of using this image for my presentation is actually Steve Jobs is considered as the master presenter in the world due to his exceptional qualities and the skills of presenting. And he's a very good presenter in the world. Right, so then I think we have time to see, watch a video, a short time. Right, so when you are going to watch this video, we have to just focus our attention towards the body language and also the PowerPoint presentation, that means the slides he has used in his presentation. Right.
I've been looking forward to 2.5 years. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone. And here it is. And the problem is that they're not so smart and they're not so easy to use. So if you kind of make a, you know, business school 101 grab with a smart axis and an easy to use axis, phones, regular cell phones are kind of right there. They're not so smart and they're, you know, not so easy to use. But smartphones are definitely a little smarter, but they actually are harder to use. They're really complicated. Just for the basic stuff, people have a hard time figuring out how to use them. But we don't want to do either one of these things. What we want to do is make a leapfrog product that is way smarter than any mobile device has ever been and super easy to use. This is what iPhone is. Okay? So, we're going to reinvent the phone. Now, we're going to start.
Actually, these are his slides. Just you want to pay attention to the slides.
With a revolutionary user interface is the result of years of research and development, and of course it's an interplay of hardware and software. Now, why do we need a revolutionary user interface? I mean, here's four smartphones, right? Motorola Q, BlackBerry, Palm Treo, Nokia E62, the usual suspects. And what's wrong with their user interfaces? Well, the problem with them is really sort of in the bottom 40 here. It's this stuff right here. They all have these keyboards that are there whether you need them or not to be there. And they all have these control buttons.
As I have limited time, I have to stop from here, right? Okay. So then the presenter and the audience, we are talking about actually these two important parts of our presentation. And there should be good rapport in between the presenter and also audience. There should be good interrelation, right? And especially you want to know about your audience. Then how are you going to know about your audience? Audience means the size of the audience. Yes, size doesn't mean that big or small, right? The size means the numbers. The numbers in the sense like, in this audience, we have nearly 20 to 25 members, right? The size of the audience and their knowledge level. the level of their knowledge. Because if I am supposed to do presentation for grade 5 scholarship students, the language I use, that has to be different. And also if I tend to do presentation for scholars, the language, like this environment, the language is a bit advanced. So then we have to think about audience and what motivates them and their interest. You want to have good relationship with the audience, otherwise the presentation is really difficult to do. Right. So the next important part is the presentation. What do we call and what is this presentation? So the PowerPoint presentation is only a supporting tool that you use in your presentation. That means when you conduct presentations. This is only a supporting tool. That is the most important part that we have to remember. And the next one is keep your pointers very simple. Keep it very simple. Because the audience, they don't like to read paragraphs and paragraphs. We have them with limited time and they also have limited time. And presenter also, when he is going to explain or when she is going to explain the thing, they have to manage their time as well. And also the next one is contextualize and explain the data on the slides. Contextualize in the sense, I've seen some presenters are there, they have something on the slide, but they speak something else. And that should not be done. Because we always want to contextualize, that means relate the points that we took. So I have only 4 points here, 4 sentences here, but I talk more than that. So that's what we needed, right? So then next one is move out from the podium. And this is actually the thing that we usually see when we do presentations. Don't plant yourself near to the podium. Don't stick to the podium. So you have to walk, that means you have to use the space. It shows that you are really confident. And also you can be very friendly with the audience, right? And you can be relaxed. So don't plant yourself near to the podium. And I can't actually walk. I can't use the space, the limited space here. So otherwise, you can use them. And also the other factor, when you are going to use the space, you can get the attention of the audience for a long time. So moving ahead, so actually this is the correct time to update. Your audience should feel captivated. So what does it mean by captivated? So we have 2 terms, captive and captivated. Your audience should feel captivated, not captive. So captivated means you want to get the attention, not by forcing. You want to get their attention actually by using your skills, presentation skills. Right? Not captive in the sense, you can't, captive means you are going to keep a person as a prisoner. So you can't, I can't keep you as prisoners for my presentation. Right? It is my talent to keep you alive and also active. Right? That is actually up to the presenter. And the next factor is focus on what your audience needs to know and not what you know. And this is also one of the major factors that we have to think when we do presentations. Especially when you are given a theme or a topic to be discussed with your audience, you have to have some limits. Maybe you are really an expert in that relevant field, but that is not the correct time to show your colors. So remember that well, we have to, when we talk something and if you are given a topic, you have to talk only that, not beyond that, because we don't have time, right? And also if you are excited what you say, the audience will too. Right, and here we have to think excited in the sense you have to be really excited if you are not pre-planned. So it is advisable to that means ready and read all the things beforehand in advance. Then you have sufficient time to that means signpost these things once again. Check these things beforehand. The special thing is when you are going to prepare a PowerPoint presentation by using your laptop. So that is your laptop and you are really familiar with that. And when you what happens when you are going to put it up onto a big screen, maybe sometimes there may be a lot of changes in the font sizes. So there are a lot of spaces there. So you have to think about these things and beforehand it is better to check everything. Then you don't want to be excited, right? And also I come to the most important part of my presentation, designing slides. So what does it mean by designing slides? And I'm not going to teach you how to design, but mostly I'm going to tell you the most important factors. Under this part, what can we talk? Designing slides? This is not related to a particular subject. For all of us, we want to know how to design slides. Right here, what am I supposed to talk? Under designing slides? Reverend sir? Any idea designing slides? No. Okay, fine. So, moving ahead, effective presentation. Under this part, I would like to talk about the font sizes and the font types and the templates and also the designs that you are going to use here. So then effective presentation, the first important thing is use your lesson plan or else content. So if you are not going to put the content into your slide, it's like a page in PowerPoint presentations. So if you are not going to put the outline, so have this outline in your mind. Then it is very easy to navigate and also run your presentation smoothly. So otherwise you are going to miss some parts, important parts of your presentation. So that is important to have an outline, and according to that you can carry on your presentation. And also next one is encapsulate one main idea. So there are some presenters I see, when they are going to present something, so they just have everything in their mind, and also they have just put everything to one slide and they try to explain. And we call this actually a rush out, right? So you are going to slide rush. So you actually, as being presenters, it is not good skill for all of us to apply. So then remember, encapsulate one main idea. You can focus only one main idea by using one slide. And next one is use effective slide design. So I'll come to that point later. What does it mean by slide design? And also the special term is effective. And avoid crowding. Avoid crowding means this is not a place or a platform to put type paragraphs and paragraphs, because apply 6x6 rule. 6x6 rule in the sense, no more 6 words per sentence, no more 6 word sentences per slide. That is the normal rule as researchers have brought out to the industry. So then 6x6 rule is that. So then it is easy to read, because always remember we have an audience in front of us to read this and understand. And they are not robots, they are human beings. They want to read and they want to absorb everything to their mind. So that is very important part. So then other thing is avoid crowding. That means the same thing. Avoid crowding is don't pack your slide. So other people, they are really confused. And also use visible font size. When we talk about font sizes, actually I have dedicated one slide for font sizes as well. But font sizes are measured by points in PowerPoint presentation, about 24 points ideal to use for body text, 32, 48, those font sizes are ideal for the topics, right? So points, that is the way that we measure the font sizes. And use no more than one slide per minute. That means, once again, by using 1 minute, you can't explain everything, use one slide. Because we want to make sure whether our audience completely these things that we talk. Templates and designs. So next, I'd like to focus your attention towards templates and designs. So we have built-in PowerPoint templates. What does it mean by built-in PowerPoint templates? Means when you use your Microsoft Windows, maybe Windows 10 or whatever the package that is after you use. So you have built-in PowerPoint templates. You are given some templates there. So, but most of the time, researchers, they say that don't use these things, because they are really familiar with everybody. So what we do is, for our easiness, we just go to PowerPoint presentation, we open that and we just go for these things. The reason is, sometimes these templates are not suitable for the subject matter that we are going to talk. The ideal, and you have number of software, that means websites to download templates. The best one is fppt.com. So you can download many templates by using that. So I can just show you the interface of that. So when you go for fppt.com, you can find the things like this. So you have education templates, and you have in education also you have historical backgrounds, you have some nature backgrounds, and everything you can find. Official backgrounds, so you can download these things for free, and then you can do your presentation, type on the presentation, right? And this is also the same background here, the nature, and you have number according to your point or the things that you're going to discuss. You can select one of the 10 minutes here. Right. So, okay, once again, here. And this one is not suitable to your presentation because this is visuals. Right? Sometimes they are not appropriate with the subject matter that you're supposed to go. And also next one, radiant colors. Because this is a professional meeting that we are going to teach something or we are going to discuss something. So here, the radiant colors, very luminous colors. Sometimes and also I'm going to talk about the colors you can apply for the templates as well. And if you choose to use building templates, and in case, if you happen to use these building templates or default templates, it is better to use a template which has minimal distraction. That means white background. You have default white backgrounds there. So minimal distraction means it's like this. And also you select a simple, very simple design without decorations. And next one is adjust the slide master to remove unnecessary elements. Slide master is there when you go to view button, you can find the slide master. So then what you do normally by using slide master is you can have uniqueness for all the slides. If you are going to do something from slide master, I can show you the interface of slide master. Once you go to view, you can have slide master. Then it is very easy to do everything. You can see click to edit master text style. When you put a text style here, it will appear on all the slides. So it's easy to run all the things from here. Otherwise, you have to change fonts and font sizes and font styles one by one. So, and the next one, use a consistent background. Consistent background means you are going to keep same standards. Don't change the things. Also, there are some presenters, when they are going to do presentations, what they normally do is they are going to change their slide designs and also the other backgrounds one by one. So it's really distracting and annoying for the audience and they don't like it. So most of the time, what happens is normally they are going to look at the slide design, not the factors. Right? When we are going to change these slide designs. But you can change slide design when you are going to start a new topic. That means change the slide background on your complete change of topic, as I did for my slide designs. So here, the next important point is typography. Some people call this as lettering. So the most important part of your PowerPoint slides. So there are actually, I don't know whether you have these idea, and we have Roman fonts. We have two types of fonts. One is called serif fonts, the other one is called sans serif font. These two terms are Latin terms. Actually, serif fonts, so you can see I have put two images here. Serif fonts, that is totally different from sans serif fonts. So serif fonts means here, you can see some flashes at the end of these strokes. So flashes means these things are flashes. So you can see some decorations at the end of the fonts. So you call these as serif fonts. Serif means decorative, fancy, decorative. And then you can see the strokes, right? The flourishes. But when we talk about sans serif fonts, the font is very clear. And you can see this, the first F and the second one. Second one, no flourishes at the end of this stroke. The letter is very clear. So you call these things as sans serif fonts. Sans means no decorations, right? So what are the serif fonts? Sans serif fonts, you know. Sans serif means this side. Sans serif fonts, do you know some sans serif fonts? So there are some official fonts that we have to use in PowerPoint. So what are the sans serif fonts? That is not sans serif. Sans serif fonts actually Times New Roman. That is
serif.
Of course, serif Times New Roman, Cambria, and Century School Book. Right, those things are Times New Roman is considered a serif font. Yes. Because the font has got flourishes at the end of the stroke. So if you talk about sans serif fonts, Arial, Calibri, Tahoma, Verdana, and Century, so then there are a number of, and also Madura, number of fonts. So when you see the font and at a glance, you can identify the font because it doesn't have actually the flourishes at the end of the stroke. The most important thing nowadays, the trend is actually, we use these two kinds of fonts in our presentations. But still, the researchers, they consider, what do you think, what is the readability quality is high, what is the font that you can use? The readability quality, when you think about that, serif or sans serif? Sans serif, yes, sans serif, because no flourishes. So then remember, when you do presentations, so my topic also, my font, Sarin also Calibri. I have used Calibri for these things, Serif X and Serif fonts. Right? So then the next one is avoid decorative or fancy fonts. So decorative fonts, actually Comic Sans, Brushes with Curls, Hot, Chiller, these things are called fancy fonts. So fancy fonts actually we don't use for official things, because we can come out humor and humorous things by using fancy fonts, right? So then remember that as well, especially Comic Sans also we don't use for PowerPoint presentations if it is really official thing. So Comic Sans, the term comic also, for the friendly message, we can use this Comic Sans. So we have actually psychology behind this typography as well. So the next one is images. So what do we think about images? So how to use images? One thing is when we use images, so one thing is if you want to use image from the internet, if you are going to download one image from the internet, so you have to make sure what is the part that you want to need. Don't put that means the whole image into your PowerPoint. So then actually you need to have knowledge about editing as well. That's very simple. So you can just cut off the other things, pop and position your image as you need. And also next one, the use always high resolution images. High resolution means actually it is visible to everybody. And actually we want to use high resolution images. High-resolution images are required for sharp reproduction, because otherwise the printing quality is very poor. So we have to think about this as well, the high-resolution images. And also high-resolution means measured by pixels. So I think IT sir knows these things well than me. So more than 1000 pixels, more than that we are going to use high-resolution images, not beyond that. So next one is crop, scale, rotate image before you insert them into PowerPoint, and try not to use clip art. So why do we say not to use clip arts? Because clip arts are really familiar images to everybody. So the audience, that means there's no actual impact of these familiar images, right? Familiar images have less impact on audience always. So if you are going to use clip arts, that is not successful. Always try to download created images from the internet. So that is very good. And moving ahead, the next one is actually original image. You can see the original image on the left side. So that is actually we have rotate. We are going to use it. Rotate and crop image is effective. And the next one is high resolution and not blurry. And here this is these two images. The one image is here. I downloaded this from internet, but I have erased. I have deleted the shutter stop. Shutter stop means the on from these images. So it is not good to use the things when we are going to prepare handouts, when we are going to use PowerPoint presentations. We have to remember that well. In the second image, I have removed that part, shutter stop. So then the image is very clear. So what do we talk about bad graphics? Actually, bad graphics means this first one on the left side, you can see can't read. So in way of putting these things to our PowerPoint presentation, too small. So the other people in the back, at the back side, so then in the back they can't read these things. And next one is animations for the sake of animations, distracting and annoying. So there are some presenters, they use animations as they wish due to prettiness. So there's nothing to do with prettiness. We have to think about these things and images as well. And have nothing to do with the presentation. Some images are there. So those images are not useful to that subject. And also next one, this graphic has covered the text. You have to be careful about that as well. And the next one is blurry or hard to see. That means low resolution image, not high resolution. So you can't see it very clearly, right? And when we talk about the next part is, now we have talked about the PowerPoint presentation and also the slide design, how to use templates and also the images, fonts, font sizes, typography. And the next important part is presentation delivery, right? So presentation delivery, when you talk about presentation delivery, this is very important part, because this is the place that you are going to perform in your presentation, right? So then what are the things that you want to know? One is your vocal elements. Inside this presentation delivery, you have vocal elements, audience rapport, and also the other thing is voice elements and body language, audience reaction. Everything can be categorized under delivery. So the first one I would like to pay my attention towards volume, pitch, pace, clarity, articulation and intonation. These things carried out can be taken under the part. part of vocal elements, right? So as being the presenter, you want to have good volume, good pitch, good pace. You want to keep pauses. You are going to keep pauses because you can't talk at a stretch, because you want to give some pauses to give chance to audience to think about something. There should be pauses in your presentation. So volume refers to the loudness of your voice, audibility, right? So how is it audible even to the backstage? You have to think about that as well if you are not using mics. So the next one is pitch. Pitch means how high or low your voice is. So you can't keep your voice at the same level at the beginning to the end. That would be really monotonous to the audience. You want to high and low, that means you want to fall and rise. So right? So next one is clarity. Pace means actually the speed at which you talk. That means you can be really slow and you can be really speed. So you won't have like, you want to talk to, because remember the audience is there to comprehend something. They want to know some facts. And also next one is actually articulation, the act of making sounds, as you all know. And intonation means the rise and fall of your sound, voice. Intonation is that. You want to think about when you talk about these, that means vocal elements, you want to think about this everything, whether you have this talent to do presentation, that means. Actually, this is not a talent, you can practice this, right? So then next one is physical appearance. Physical appearance means, under this part, we can talk about gestures and postures. So what does it mean by gestures? Gestures means your hand movements, the gestures, yes. How we are going to use, of course, right, thank you. So the next one is postures. Postures means your body movements. How you use the space, like as I told you earlier, don't plant yourself near to the podium, and that means you don't have really good postures. Postures means how you use the space, and the gestures means how you use your hand movements. So remember, when you are going to use these gestures and postures, these gestures and postures should be really natural and should appropriate to the speaking audience. Right? If you are going to use the gestures as you wish, that is not effective. Remember that as well. And when you talk about facial expressions, so this is one of the crucial part of our presentation, facial expressions. How you are going to create facial expressions? So what can we talk about facial, what can be included inside these facial expressions? So now I can see very nice facial expressions are there, right, from my audience. So even the smile can be taken under facial expression. That is actually very powerful facial expression, smile. Because sometimes you don't think about these things because it matters a lot. And smile can be used to show that you are really open, you are friendly, right? And you don't have nervousness, so you can communicate openness, friendliness, and especially confidence, right? So next one is facial expressions and also eye contacts. And remember, facial expression should be natural, and you can see in the pictures as well. Eye contact. So eye contact can be used to establish especially credibility, right? And also this can be taken as, eye contact can be considered as one of the most important points to engage us to our audience, right? Because then that means make sure that you are not going to miss any person in the audience. So that is important in that sense, right? And then next point is general body movements. So your body plays an important role when you are going to do presentation. General body movements, actually, we can see some nonverbal adapters due to anxiety. So tapping your foot and sometimes wringing hands, or curling your hair, or playing with the paper clips, sometimes jingling sound from the pocket. So don't carry something to it. That means don't take anything to your hand, then automatically you tend to do, right? Because you feel anxious sometimes. So remember that as well. So general body movements are really important, because we have to think always, we are not going to do this presentation alone. We have an audience in front of us. We have to think about them as well. So that is a very important part there. So as the last point, so I come to latter part of my presentation. Now I am going to keep concluding remarks actually. So sometimes many speakers' expressive faces turn to deadpans due to their anxiety when they ask to stand in front of the crowd. So almost all the people, they have this experience when they are going to do this presentation. First 2-3 minutes are going to be really crucial for any expertise. So I thoroughly believe that. Even for me, even for you. So if you ask to do, if you're supposed to do presentation, first 2-3 minutes you take to free and shy, you take to, you know, familiar with the audience. Take that time. Right, so then always remember we have to rehearse and rehearse and rehearse before you go to go near to the podium, because remember, if you are going to read beforehand, if you want to read about your material, and if you want to read about your material well, and also then you have sufficient time to do some changes if you want to do changes, and it is better to check your presentation before you do it, check your presentation by using your projector. Because there may be sometimes changes that you really feel excited, right? So then that is very important part, and I love this quote very much. If you fail to prepare, you are prepared to fail. So this is very important. If you fail to prepare, means this is not this is the quotation from Mark Spitz. So if you fail to prepare your presentation, you are prepared to fail in front of your audience. That is my message for the day. So thank you very much, everybody, for such an attentive listening. So I hope you got something. Yes, thank you.
Excellent and very useful for the so this time to open discussion, we can do some ideas.
Her presentations to us, like all in almost all the slides, she used common sense. used a lot of kiddies, kick parts as well. Right? So I think it depends on the audience and especially your attitude. Right? So if you want to be informal in the presentation, so then you can be informal. Like that. So other than that, I thought it's a very nice presentation and everybody would agree. So all the best.
Thank you very much, and I also, yes, of course. But I got font sizes and font types. Actually, I referred this one. This is international book for about PowerPoint presentations. So in here that they have mentioned Comic Sans and also other fancy fonts are not suitable for the presenting when you are in that means official audience, so professional audience. And this is actually international pedagogical ICT license for the teachers, especially for the teachers who teach. Anyway, I accept your point. So I referred this book to show that. Thank you very much.
Another thing, while you are presenting this, and they have sounds and noisy things here and there, and some talking. So as a presenter, what would you like to do?
Actually, if this is actually, if this is my classroom, I can apply many tricks there. And as this is academic, actually a professional gathering, so I think from their side also there should be some discipline, right?
You pay your attention.
Of course, I heard everything, yes. And actually that was not distracting to my side and annoying. So then I was able to carry out on it further.
Don't care about those.
But if it is unintentional, you can't do anything about it. So in my case, like I got a call because I'm arranging a guest lecture.
Yes.
So I got a call, so I didn't want to disturb, that's why I wanted
she
to
go yes, out. Outside.
But then my shoe got tangled here and
so normally actually those things can happen in a room, so those things we can't avoid. And as the students also, yeah, as the other people also, there may be certain things and we have to actually, we have to expect those things in a room.
And some presenters are actually looking at those things and we add something and we just, they have sound.
Yes, we can use that thing as a technique. That thing as a technique we can use. Actually, some presenters they use jogging, professional jogging as the technique to their presentation skills. So that can be accepted in some situations. Sometimes some presenters they have to do presentations from morning to night. That means evening, from 8 o'clock to 5 o'clock. Then that presenter he himself want to add some techniques to keep alive his audience. Right, thank you very much. I suppose.
Yeah, actually, it was a good presentation. I think you proved how to be a good presenter. So, I also have one point to add that, as Swami said, that actually, I also use Comic Sans and all because I think that if we want to get attention, more attention of the audience, I think we can change points. That's my point. And the other thing, my point you said that we have used the space if you are doing a presentation in the classroom, actually we can move here and there. But if we are using more space in a professional presentation, it's unprofessional, I think.
Yes, that's why, of course, thank you very much for pointing out that. And that's why I said in here, I can't use the space, I can't walk around because these are not my students. So then I don't want to walk around. We do that to get the attention of the students, other audience, right? So in order to get the audience, if actually